Hello everyone, so good to see you. Tears of the Kingdom is finally upon us. It's been such a long journey, but we're finally here. And to celebrate that, I want to just talk. Not make any crazy deep retrospective, not make any like top 10 facts or whatever. You can actually find that elsewhere on the channel right now. But no, I want to talk about the importance of The Legend of Zelda, what it's given to us, whether you've been with the series since the very beginning, or you started with Breath of the Wild. Because this is a special series. It's the kind of series where you remember where you've been and where you were in life as you picked up your sword and dove headfirst into adventure. And we've all had our own legends unfold, sometimes by our own choice and sometimes through someone else. The very first Legend of Zelda game I ever played was Ocarina of Time, and I wasn't even the one playing it. Over one summer, my cousin would come over every day, since her family was too busy and she couldn't stay home alone. We were like 9? 10 years old? She saw that I had a Nintendo 64, and so the next day, she brought, I believe, what was her brother's copy of Ocarina of Time, and we started playing. Or rather, I got to watch her play. I wasn't really allowed to play, I guess, because it wasn't my game? I didn't really question it, but she didn't exactly know everything about the game, so we went on this journey together. We would play a couple of hours every day, sometimes getting more progress done, sometimes getting even more lost. Not understanding how some things worked, figuring it out together, feeling that elation from beating a boss, or being too afraid to get the Sun Song from under the royal tomb because re-deads were really scary. I'm still a little traumatized, but it's the fact that I didn't even play the game, and those experiences are burned into my mind. They're very personal memories, and I'm grateful that I got to share those with her. Love you, Ash. My cousin Ash, not the one from GBG, and it's a little confusing. I love you too, Ash! From these moments, my curiosity in the series sparked. Honestly, I feel like I would have gravitated towards Zelda anyways, eventually, because it was just so saturated in Nintendo Power Magazine, playing as Link in Smash Brothers. It just seemed like a natural fit for someone like me. I eventually caught sight of the game being sold used at this little stand at our local mall, and I asked my grandpa if I could get it. And he did, bless his soul, and I still have it today. Thank you, Grandpa. I played it, and even though it was on my own time this time, it evoked a different feeling. This wasn't Mario 64, Banjo-Kazooie, or Kirby 64. This took itself pretty seriously, and I appreciated that, even while playing it in solitude. I kinda already knew what I was getting myself into and what to do, but there were still moments of discovering things on my own that kept the magic alive. So I became a Zelda fan. Was there more, I wondered? I unfortunately didn't have my Super Nintendo anymore, so I couldn't play games like A Link to the Past. My grandpa gave it back, because it was his, gave it back to my cousins, and I never saw it again. That was a sad day. I kept my eyes glued to Nintendo Power, at a game that looked a whole lot like Ocarina of Time, but just kind of weird? So I turned away from it for a while, and then I saw those commercials.
Radio Zelda is now transmitting.
He's playing. I knew it!
Just a reminder, 72 hours remaining until the end of the world.
The marketing for this commercial is fantastic, by the way. It's portrayed as if everyone around the world is tuning into Link going around Termina as he's trying to save the world in real time within these 3 days. It is astoundingly bleak and dire. There are shots of people losing hope, the radio host letting people call in to let their family know they love them. To encourage them to brace themselves that the world is probably going to end?
Hello, caller.
Hello?
Are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Go ahead. We're listening.
I just...
Believe in the boy.
Mom, I love you. And Dad, I miss you. I'm sorry.
It's okay.
The acting leaves a bit to be desired watching it now, but at the time, it was really intense. I mean, there's a line that whispers... What? Nintendo marketing would not let that fly in today's age. There was something about those commercials that really struck a chord with me, and I realized from that moment that as much as I hate the jump scare kind of horror, it's the psychological kind of terror that fascinates me. It hit me in a certain way because I was just watching someone's entire playthrough of Ocarina of Time, and now the whole world is watching this. This encapsulated the feeling of dread and despair that The Legend of Zelda Majora's Mask swells with. It takes me back to those early screenshots of Zelda Gaiden that I have within my very first issue of Nintendo Power Magazine, and I'm like, what in the world is going on in this game? Why is it so scary yet so intriguing? I ended up playing it, the first Zelda game I would play on my own, and wasn't very good at it. Being Deku Link threw me off. I felt like I was supposed to beat the game within those very fast 3 days, and I kinda panicked. Was I doing the game wrong? But upon witnessing the first cycle, seeing Zelda for a moment, which made you feel safe, then becoming Link with the knowledge that, oh, I can reset at any time, gives you a renewed sense of power. That hope, shining amongst a continuous, encapsulating cycle of despair. Figuratively and narratively, I was the same Link, and I felt like I could take this challenge on. And with every subsequent playthrough, I understood just how fascinating the story, the characters wove into it, and the messages they deliver, come together to construct one of my favorite games of all time. From that point, I pretty much played whatever Zelda came out that piqued my interest. 2D Zelda, 3D Zelda, each one delivering a new adventure, new music to get stuck in my head, new characters to enrich the overarching story. They each carry a unique experience that has stuck with me, and counting the days to a new Zelda release always gets everyone just so collectively excited. It's a very beautiful moment when you finally do get to be in control of something that you've been waiting years, and I mean years, for. Having that opening scene finally play out in Breath of the Wild triggered a really surreal feeling in me. It's like, wow, we're finally here, finally. And yet for that game in particular, it's so quiet. It was so subtle, you know? Popping out of your little pod after Zelda talks to you, there's something very powerful about silence in this game that I wish more people would take the time to understand. From the moment you start the game, there's no big fanfare, there's no triumphant main theme, it's just you. You gather yourself, you learn some basic controls as you shuffle your way out of the cave, and then the shot that changed the world. Just knowing you can go anywhere that you see, that beautiful vista, the music swelling, the fact that you're here, you made it, you waited this long, gushing with that feeling that this is a different kind of game altogether. The camera pans back to you, telling you, alright, the world is yours. With control reined in your hands, you excitedly jump off the cliff and die immediately. Isn't it magical? It feels so rare to have that feeling of mystique and curiosity, especially the older that we get. I think a lot of us recall the very first story-driven game we've ever played pretty fondly. We likely didn't appreciate the medium the way we did back then as much as we probably do now. But storytelling like this, in a world that you can embrace, wander around, interact with, and witness the consequences of your actions, I have no idea what I'd be doing right now, if not for this art form. Do you remember when all there was to worry about was school and a little bit of math and reading? You would get home on a Friday, maybe play a little bit before or after homework, then just did your own thing until it was time for bed. And then you would wake up on a Saturday, and the only thing in front of you was the weekend and that adventure. Maybe you just got the Master Sword. Maybe you were stuck in a dungeon and told yourself, alright, I'm gonna figure this out today. You might have just found the most recent item to play with, or perhaps it was time to take on Ganon. Those moments are so precious. And if you're like my friends around my age, you can't really have a Saturday like that anymore. We're adults now. We've got jobs to do and worry about, tasks that we might be procrastinating on. Or some of us might have kids who obviously take priority. It can be rough and sobering. But at the same time, I don't think that means we have to say goodbye to those magical days forever. In fact, I saw a lot of those feelings reemerge when Breath of the Wild came out. Just weeks of people starting at the exact same points, building their story, their own personal, unique adventure through this massive expanse of this beautiful Hyrule. Those were the moments I was living for at the time, just people sharing their experiences that only they had. I'd hang out with fellow friends or co-workers at the time, and we would just talk Zelda like we were just gathering around a campfire to tell stories of what we've seen or where we've been. Here's one example. I was trekking around the Faerun region, hearing that incessant ping telling me, hey, there's a shrine around here. So I looked and I looked, I climbed mountains, I fell down, it was a whole ordeal. I think I gave up for a bit, and then I found myself falling into a ravine as the current pushed me down. I took a while to gather myself and figure out what I could do to get out of here. And then the music changed for no reason. What did I do? Was I in danger? Then electricity started to fall on me. What was happening? So I looked up, and there it was, framed perfectly in the ravine above me, one of the dragons that roam around Hyrule. And my jaw dropped. I had no idea these dragons were even a thing in this game at that time. It was haunting and beautiful, especially with the music beside it. It was one of my favorite stories to share, and it kind of incited other people to share stories of their own. I can't say that there's any other game that has collectively captivated so many people at the same time like that before. There are also moments that just make you stop and go, wow, this is so visually striking. I will never forget the first time I wandered in the Lost Woods in Breath of the Wild. Link, holding that torch with the hood on, exploring this mystifying forest with trees flashing somewhat sinister smiles at you. And what brings it all together? The music. There was something so picturesque and yet haunting, a feeling that only the medium of video games can conjure up from inside of you. For me, at least, these moments are where you're transported into that world, where you are in the Lost Woods, trying to solve the mystery of this forest. There's obviously different points in the series from one person to the next, but I think all of them have those moments of immersion where it isn't just a game, but those sections where you are Link. I guess what I'm saying is, it's probably going to be a very long time before we get to revel in the anticipation of a new Zelda game coming out in just mere days as it is right now. People will go on blackout and banish social media from their devices because they want to have that pure experience. Assuming you avoided any spoilers out there, we're going in fairly blind. So I want to ask you to do something. If you're seeing this the week of the release of Tears of the Kingdom, go hard this week. Get a little more work done than you'd be asked for. Tie up some of those loose ends before Friday. Write an extra page of that script. Get that commission done. Send those emails. If you're in school, get that assignment done early. And just wrap up anything you have as much as you can by Friday. And then take Saturday for yourself. Dive headfirst into an adventure where you have absolutely no idea what to expect. Take that day, because you've been working hard, and we're proud of you. You deserve to take this moment, to take this day, and start writing your own history through this version of Hyrule. It's a feeling that encompasses so much more. There's going to be those times that we look back and say, man, I wish I could go back to that day. Sometimes it's the nostalgia that keeps us going. It can hit us in the most mundane of moments. It's always those little moments that meant a lot to us back then, and even to kids now. Maybe it's when you booted up your 3DS for the first time to set it up, eager to play that first game you got with it. It could be when you were scrolling through the setup or punching your birthday in. The feeling of putting in the game that would one day be one of your favorites and starting it up for the first time. Making your very first Mii and poking around at them in the plaza. Encountering your very first Street Pass with a friend or with a stranger. Those quiet, personal moments on a summer afternoon where it's just you and your Game Boy in the bedroom. That drive home with a game where you're so excited to play it that you open the box and read the instruction manual on the way home, gearing yourself up for the memories you're about to make. These are an entire collective of gaming experiences that make up our own story, and it's a shame to see people lose that sense of wonder as time goes on. And it can be healing too. I quite appreciate that Tears of the Kingdom just happens to fall during Mental Health Awareness Month. The Zelda series, in my opinion and experiences, helps people through a lot of difficult times. When I was in high school, I had a friend who was playing Link's Awakening DX, and at the time, they were coping with the loss of someone in their lives. And they mentioned how this was able to help them push through that experience. And then more recently, a friend who used Breath of the Wild as a means to start to overcome the feeling of not being in control as they learned how to adapt to the world and find their own solutions to problems. Some people say how it's deflating how that game becomes much easier over time, but there's plenty of people who cherish the novelty of not only gaining that empowerment, but retaining it. Isn't it fascinating how many different ways that these games can resonate with us? That kind of mental instability happens to me too. I've had times in my life where I'm trying to enjoy a game or a moment to myself, and no matter what time of day it is or what else I accomplished earlier, I get that feeling of, you could be working on something more productive right now. You could be making something, you could be cleaning something, you could be doing this, that. It happens all the time. The inner voice can get very loud at times, and unfortunately, it's such a common feeling for some of us. I mean, it's good to have a work ethic, but you also need to allow yourself to decompress as well. Going 100% all the time, it wears you down, and it's harder for some people to achieve the mindset of relaxing worry-free with a game than it can be for others. You deserve to have those moments still, of being able to wake up first thing in the morning, to roll over to your new favorite game without the guilt of responsibility weighing over you. I'm not saying to completely neglect your daily tasks, but it's absolutely healthy to give your mind that mental break it requires. It's a scary world out there. Sometimes you really do need a game like Zelda to escape somewhere and just allow yourself to go on an adventure. And honestly, it doesn't matter if this is going to be the very first Zelda game you played or not. That just means your journey can start right now. There are people who've started with Ocarina of Time, and those who are playing it for the first time this year. I definitely didn't play every Zelda game on its original hardware, but they still carry that magical feeling of going on a journey that many series just can't reach the level of, and they take you to so many places. The set pieces can be vastly different from one game to the next. The art style finds a way to complement the mood and setting so well. A lot of the times you go on that journey by yourself, but sometimes maybe you have a friend or two by your side. They also might make you feel kind of silly, or maybe that's exactly what immerses you as the hero. There's some hardcore fans that might still have Zelda games they never finished before, so don't feel bad or that your opinion on the series means any less than someone else's. I'm so thankful that the Switch brought over several Zelda games to the platform, some that I get to experience for the first time myself. It's one of my favorites, and probably always will be. These are the moments that become talking points for you to discuss with others. People will be talking about this at gatherings, at school, streams, podcasts, social media posts, and videos just like this one. Where in Hyrule, or beyond, will the wind carry you next? Can't wait to find out. I am living for these stories that will be told, man. They are ready to be written. The same beginning, and the same ending. But also much that becomes your own legend in between. Hope I see you out there. Till we meet again.